Good afternoon, everyone. Thank you for joining us today. My name is Jana Rawls, and I'm the marketing manager here at Cloud for Good. I'm excited to have on the line today Jenna Pendleton with National Breast Cancer Foundation and our senior consultant, Kim Schaefkes, as well, to talk with you about Lightning. I do want to let everyone know that you are on mute today. If you are unable to see the presentation, please put a message in the chat window. Additionally, if you have any questions, please put those in the chat window as well. We have allowed time at the end of today's presentation to answer your questions. Before I turn this over to Jenna and Kim, I do want to give you a quick overview of Cloud for Good in case you're joining us today and not familiar with our company. Before I do that, though, I did want to share another client success. We think National Breast Cancer Foundation is a great success, and they're doing awesome with Lightning. But I did want to share another story with you as well. The Muscular Dystrophy Association is leading the fight to free individuals and the families that love them from the harm of muscular dystrophy, ALS, and related muscle debilitating diseases that take away physical strength, independence, and life. MDA was previously using multiple systems to manage their clients and support programs. After implementing the Nonprofit Success Pack, MDA has seen productivity increases greater than 25% and was able to produce a report of all the families living in flooded parishes in Louisiana that may have been impacted by the floods in August of 2016. They were able to reach out to all of these families to confirm their safety and inquire if they needed assistance, all within a 24-hour time period. With their previous systems, this wouldn't have been possible. This is just one of our successes out of the 1,000 implementations that we have completed since we were launched back in 2010. We find that lots of our clients are having success with the platform. We recently, right before Dreamforce, launched our State of Salesforce report and found that 72% of our clients can communicate more effectively with Salesforce, 76% say it's easier to do their work with the platform, and 97% see the potential for innovation with Salesforce. This innovation is possible because we can now touch each department within your organization, helping you be more efficient and effective. One of the Cloud for Good advantages is that we are certified across all the Salesforce applications, and we have experience with many applications that can enhance your Salesforce experience. Whether it is a solution to help you better communicate with your constituents via marketing automation tools or a case management application to help you offer more services, we have both the experience and the expertise. Since we launched in 2010, we have seen tremendous growth. Our customers see us as a trusted partner, allowing us to give more back to our respected communities via our social corporate responsibility program. And our employees have voted us a best place to work 2 years in a row. We were actually made it to the top 50 best small businesses to work for back in 2016, so last year, and we were recognized by Fortune magazine. We are part of the Pledge 1% movement, where we give back 1% of our product, 1% of our time, and 1% of our profits to nonprofits. To date, we've given back over $95,000 in grants, completed over 1,000 implementations, and we are around just over 50 employees. None of this would have been possible without the best team ever. All of our employees are full-time. We don't subcontract out any client-facing work. We are all Salesforce certified. And all of us have walked a mile in your shoes. We have nonprofit experience ranging from fundraising to fundraising to program management and everything in between. We had also, this is possible because we do have our proven methodology. We don't only connect you with the best Salesforce talent, but we take everything you have to say to heart and listen to your needs. We plan and configure a system that will help you accomplish your goals. We set up the system to meet your specifications. Then you get to confirm that the system meets your needs before you are actively involved using your new Salesforce solution. It doesn't stop there, though. We do offer training and ongoing support packages. And last year, we launched the Customer for Life program. Once a goodie, always a goodie. All of these are a series of webinars that dive deep into other Salesforce concepts, and we'll give you more information on reporting. I encourage you to reach out to me directly if you have an idea for a Customer for Life webinar, because we do want to provide you with the tools you need to maximize your solution. And now, without further ado, I will turn this over to Jenna and Kim, and they will tell you all about Lightning.
Wonderful. Thank you, Jana. Hello. My name is Jenna Pendleton, and I'm a business analyst for the National Breast Cancer Foundation. I've had the pleasure of working with Cloud for Good for the past 2 years, and in particular with Kim. Kim, would you like to tell a little bit about yourself?
Sure. Thanks, Jenna. My name is Kim Schafkis. I'm a senior cloud consultant here at Cloud for Good. I've been here about 3 years and have been working with Jenna and her team at the National Breast Cancer Foundation for just about 2 years now to get them up and running a nonprofit success pack and Lightning, and we're excited to share that with you guys today.
Thank you, Kim. We have so enjoyed working with Cloud for Good, and in particular with Kim. They're a large part of what has made our Salesforce system so successful. So I'd like to first tell you just a little bit about the National Breast Cancer Foundation. And at NBCF, our mission is helping women now. We do this by providing help and inspiring hope to those who are affected by breast cancer through early detection, education, and support services. But before we jump into the bulk of our content today, I'd like to give you just a little bit of background on NBCF's history with Salesforce. So back in 2008, we migrated from Razor's Edge to Salesforce. So Razor's Edge is another a CRM system. And at the time, we thought it was a really great idea to make our Salesforce system function like Razor's Edge. Hindsight's 2020, and now we see that that was really not a good idea because it left us with a really customized system that just made it really difficult for us to do what we wanted to. So let me tell you just a little bit about the issues with our old system. One of the biggest issues was that we had miscategorized accounts and record types, which led to just really dirty data. It was not the most helpful in making business decisions because we just couldn't really count on our data being true. Additionally, we weren't on a platform that would support nonprofits, so something like the Nonprofit Success Pack, and we also weren't able to utilize native Salesforce functionality, nor were we able to integrate with any other systems. So to top it all off, our uploads just took a really long time. So I don't know if any of you have some of these same problems in your system or what your system looks like exactly, but for all of these reasons, we decided to jump into a re-implementation of our Salesforce system last year in 2016. So in this implementation, we focused on solving the pain points of our old system. Let me show you just a few highlights of our new functionality. First, to correct some of our dirty data problems, we implemented the Nonprofit Success Pack and the Household Account Model. The Nonprofit Success Pack brought us native Salesforce functionality that was tailored to nonprofits, as well as some really wonderful extras like the Nonprofit Success Pack upload and the payment object. And then the Household Account Model helped us streamline our individual donors. And in the re-implementation, we cleaned up some of our misclassified data. So the household account model now helps us to keep that data clean. Another feature of our new system is the ability to automate processes. We have automated emails for our fundraising department now and also some of our development departments, which has just put a lot of time back into their weeks, and they're pretty excited about that. And then finally, what we had really been waiting for, we're now able to integrate with other systems. So this is really exciting for us. We have integrated with Classy, who we've been with for a really long time, but we had never been able to integrate because of our old system. And then we're currently in the process of integrating with HubSpot, our new email provider. And then we are also vetting some general ledger and e-signature platforms that would integrate with our Salesforce system. Being able to integrate with other systems has really opened up a whole new world for us, because instead of importing reports from Classy, they just feed right in. It's wonderful. So today, we've been on our new system for about a year, and on this webinar, I'd like to show you how we got there. Over the next few minutes, Kim and I will share a little bit about NBCF's experience with Lightning, including what made us decide to turn on Lightning, the method that we use to increase user adoption, what our experience has been on Lightning, and a few steps that you can take today to prepare for your move to Lightning. So I often get asked how we decided to turn on Lightning for our org. And in some ways, the decision might have been a little bit easier for us since we were already making other changes within our org. But we did have a really big concern on whether or not Lightning would be too big of a change for our users, since we had all these other things that we were also changing on them. But ultimately, we decided that our business need for the overhaul of our system was to take advantage of all that Salesforce had to offer, and that Lightning would accomplish this for us. So we decided to go for it and add Lightning to the list of things that we were implementing. So I'd like to show you in a bit just a few of our favorite things about Lightning. But first, I'd like to show you the method that we used in order to increase our user adoption. So we focused on four main areas. We focused on four main areas. First, we focused on the knowledge of the product. So in this case, Lightning. Also, we focused on how our product would affect our processes internally, how we would make decisions within our organization about our Salesforce system and about what this implementation would look like, and then finally, how we use effective communication to get our users on board. So let's take a little bit of a deeper look at what we mean by knowledge of our product. So if your product is Lightning, it's best to know its biggest wins and some of its shortfalls for your org. So since every organization uses Salesforce a little bit differently, it's helpful to know just what how capable Lightning currently is for what your system does. So you don't have to know everything, but be able to fill in the gaps with resources or individuals that you can go to. So that could be Cloud for Good, and then at the end of the presentation, we'll show you some places for resources specifically on Lightning. Also, we found it really helpful to educate our users on the business need for the change. So for us, the business need was taking advantage of the latest and greatest from Salesforce and being able to get all the functionality of latest releases. Our users were really on board for this because they had really experienced a lot of the pain points. So I hope that's kind of the same for your organization if you decide to go to Lightning. Once you know your product and the business need for it, you can move on to how the product affects your internal processes. So for the National Breast Cancer Foundation, we use Salesforce for fundraising. So we have users who enter checks and perform uploads, some who deal mostly in peer-to-peer campaigns, and then some users who manage our corporate partners. So each of these user processes were changed to some degree by Lightning, and having a general understanding of their day-to-day, most frequently used objects, and some of the actions that they generally perform, I was able to point out some of the ways that Lightning would change their processes, or if I couldn't tell them, I could point them to resources for some more information. So now that we've talked about knowledge of the product and we understand how it will affect our internal processes, let's take a look at how to facilitate business decisions within your organization, and how we can increase the user adoption by making our users more a part of that process. So the first step towards effective business decision making is identifying your, identifying your stakeholders. At the National Breast Cancer Foundation, I told you that we use Salesforce for fundraising. So our main stakeholders are our corporate development and fundraising users. So after we determined that these are our stakeholder departments, we took a look to figure out our decision makers. These are people that we knew we needed to have on board in order to make this transition to Lightning really successful. And we determined that our decision makers were individuals from our stakeholder departments, but we also identified our CFO, who was our executive sponsor, and a few individuals from finance and accounting. We thought that they were also decision makers because we use our Salesforce system also as a sub-ledger to our general ledger in accounting. So they have a little bit of stake in the game as well. And finally, we took our decision makers and determined an approvals process. So we decided to implement a document that our decision makers signed at each major milestone in our project. On the screen is one of our stage sign-off documents. In it, we included the milestone that we were completing, so in this case, the analyze stage, and then more specifically, the scope of what the individuals were signing off on. So I included a space for each individual to sign, and I circulated the document instructing users that if they had any hesitations in signing it, they could come back to me or let me know. Really, a lot of the times, I walked it over to the individuals' offices and had a conversation around their comfort level with the implementation. I really encourage you to implement a document or possibly an email similar to this in your organization, because I found it really helpful for two reasons. One, it facilitated a conversation with anyone who felt uneasy about the changes, and otherwise I don't think they would have come to me. And it also opened up an avenue to make any adjustments if needed. So I would say this is just the number one most helpful thing we did to increase buy-in on the implementation. It really made our users feel like they were a valued part of the process. So secondly, having this document made it really clear when individuals signed off on a step, and it kind of took away the ability for them to later come back and say they weren't sufficiently trained or they didn't agree with the changes that had happened, because there was a point in time that I actually got their signature saying that they were good with it. So at the National Breast Cancer Foundation, we implemented these changes at each Cloud for Good stage in the process. So Kim, would you like to explain a little bit more about the Cloud for Good methodology that goes along with your stages?
Sure.
Oh, sorry.
So at Cloud for Good, we have a methodology that we use as throughout our implementation projects. And Jana talked about them briefly at the beginning, but I'll talk to you about them in slightly more detail. We have five stages. The first one is analyze. So once the National Breast Cancer Foundation or any of our clients, they had identified that they had a need, who their decision makers were, who their stakeholders were, and what sort of their pain points were, and they engaged with us, we sat down with them, with our team, to talk through those things and understand their perspective. What's working? What's not working? What would you like to do that you can't do today? What does your system look like? Things like that. What are you trying to integrate? And really get a good understanding of what their system is and where they kind of want it to go. And at the end of that stage, we recap all of that for their stakeholders. And did we hear what you are telling us correctly? Did we listen? Did we capture it all? Is there something we missed, or we went too far on one thing or not far enough on another? It's a good opportunity for them and their decision makers and stakeholders to really work with us and make sure that what we're going to build makes sense for them. Once that's approved, we move to our design stage. So we go back and take a look at all of those requirements and understanding of what they need and how is that going to work in the system. Is it new fields? Is it a new integration? Is it a new object, new reporting? What is that? And outline that for them and take that back to those stakeholders and decision makers and present that. Here's what we would like to do in order to accomplish these goals that you have. If they approve of that, we'll move on to the build stage where we'll actually build it out for them and make all of the new reports or integrations or fields or objects or whatever that happens to be, automation. And then at the end of that, we'll review it and say, here's what your requirements were, here's how we decided to accomplish that, and here's the actual build of it, and get everyone's buy-in that it looks like what we expected to look like. And sometimes those things change, you know, when you articulate a requirement or a need and the fruition of that at the end of build don't always jive. So we go through that, and then we open the system up to the client to say, all right, take a look. Is this exactly what we were thinking it was going to be? Does it look good to you? Does it work the way you expect it to work? Are there any tweaks that we need to make? And get the stakeholders and decision makers to really grab onto the system and understand that we have accomplished the goal, we have met the needs, and that this new system will work better than the system they have today or they're looking to move towards. And then once that's done and we have some approval on that, then we'll move further down the line to train their staff, train the employees, move the data from one system to another, and get everybody up and running and live on their new system. And that is generally how Cloud for Good works with our clients to manage that process throughout.
Perfect. Thank you, Kim. I know at NBCF, we really enjoyed working with Cloud for Good through this methodology. They just were really helpful for us. The stages were really effective for decision makings internally for us. So now that we've covered kind of what it looks like to know your product and understanding how it will affect your organization and their processes, we've put together an approvals process specific to your organization. So let's look at how we can leverage communication to increase user adoption at your organization. There are really two main items that I think are most important to communicate. The first would be the timeline. So making sure that everyone knows the large project end date or time period is great, but since that has a very high likelihood of changing, I found it a lot more important to just make sure users knew what the next step was, or maybe the next few steps. But I try at every end, to end any meeting or to end an email with the next step and what its timeline was. I found that really helped our users know what was coming. And secondly, communicate expectations. So I made it a point to be really clear with our users about what was expected of them. If you sound like a broken record, at least your users can't say they didn't hear it. I recently heard from a project manager that I was talking to that unless your users are tired of hearing it, you aren't communicating it enough. So that's good. So here it is. Our method for increasing our user adoption. By knowing our product, understanding how it will affect our users' processes, establishing a decision-making process within our organization, and then communicating effective information. Also, you can increase user adoption within your Salesforce instance. So let me tell you a little bit about our experience on Lightning. One of the most frequent questions I get is, was Lightning all that you expected it to be, and did you hit any major bumps in the road? So with Lightning, we were expecting a lot of change, and it definitely was a lot of change. So we implemented about a year ago, and Lightning was still pretty new. So there were a few kinks that were still getting worked out at the time. And when we switched over to Lightning, it was icon-based, and there were a few functions that hadn't been transitioned yet. And some of those things kind of surprised us, but Cloud for Good helped us really roll with the punches and get our users up to speed on the new system. Also, Salesforce has changed a lot of things within Lightning, even just through the year that we've been on the system. And a lot of it has actually been changed to be a little more user-friendly for people coming from Classic. So I think you would probably enjoy that if you're currently on Classic. So of the functions that aren't available in Lightning right now that we're using, almost all of them are admin functions. So our admin users switch back to Lightning a little bit more than our normal users, and I really only know one other user within our organization that ever switches back to Classic. But I'd like to show you a little bit of our system today. So I'll show you five of our favorite functions within our new Lightning-enabled system, and I'll even give you a little bit of a peek into our live org. So one of the things that we love most about our new system is the ease of use. So one thing that I love the most about Lightning is that it has tabs for view instead of one long page of data. So let me switch into our system, and I'll show you a little bit what I mean. Okay. Kim, can you see that?
I can, yep.
Okay, perfect. Okay, so this is our Lightning system, and this is our actual org. I've created a few example objects so that you guys can see a little bit into our org. So it's not as robust as a normal object would be. But currently we're in a contact, and you can see some information up at the top, and we've been able to customize the information that we wanted to show up here. And one of the new things within Lightning is that there are two tabs rather than one long list of data like you see in Classic. So right now we're on the Related tab, and this shows any sort of object that that could be related to a contact within Salesforce. And then if we switch over to the Details tab, it shows the information about the specific contact. So what I really like about this is that if you're looking for something specifically on the contact, like you're wanting to find their address or something, you go to the Details tab, and then you can scroll down and see whatever that is. But if you're looking for something that's related to the contact, you can easily see those objects on the Related tab. So let me show you the account that is associated with this contact. And this account has some related objects. So you can see that on the Related tab we have my contact and then also an opportunity. If we had soft credits or anything else, those would also be here. So this is my favorite part about Lightning. And then we still have the Details tab that shows you the primary contact and other information that you'd get on a normal household account. So let me show you the opportunity. So this is a sample opportunity that I made, but it looks just like a normal one that we'd have. Across the top, we have stages within our opportunities. So some of our corporate partners are set up with more of a normal, like what you'd typically see as a sales cycle. So we have these stages that talk about agreements and promotion wrap-ups and things like that. So here we can see the activity and the chatter, but then again we have a Details tab for the opportunity. And then I could go down to this stage and edit the stage from proposal development to proposal presentation. And it moves along on this bar up here. But I can also just click whatever I want to move it to and select Mark as Current Stage, and it just moves right along, which is much more fun. So this is just a little bit of a peek into our Salesforce system. Over here we'd have any like dedications or payments or anything that's related to an opportunity, but I just wanted to show you a little bit about our actual live system. I'll go back into our presentation. One of the next really neat things that that we enjoy about our Lightning-enabled system is the Kanban or Kanban view. I don't know how you say it, but we really like it. It's new for us. It originally came out just on opportunities for stages, so kind of what I just showed you where you could move something along on that bar on the top. This is a different view, but it deals with the same fields that those did. But in this last release, I think the spring release, it was also the Kanban or Kanban was rolled out to leads and contracts and campaigns. So this is really great, and I think it can actually be on any drop-down field within opportunities, leads, contracts, and campaigns. But that's really great because I know a lot of organizations don't, or a lot of nonprofit organizations don't use Salesforce exactly the way we do with that looks like more like a sales cycle. So if you don't, this really opens the door for you to be able to use this view as well. And it's just a fun way to, you can do all of this just with drop-downs, but making it more fun for your users has never helped, you know? So we really enjoy this feature. Next, we have graphical reporting. So this is something that can give you a chance to see trends from your data at a glance and also gives you the ability to build graphical dashboards, which is also new with Lightning. I find this most useful when I am running a report to find some high level of data, like if we get more donations from X versus Y or something else like that, usually to answer an executive's question. So if I'm really in the weeds on data, it's not all that helpful, but lately I've run some reports and shown the graph to see do we have more users of this type or some other type. So it's just helpful to see if you're trying to answer a high-level question. Also, I know sometimes I used to have to run a report, export it into Excel, and then pivot table it or do some sort of a graph off of it, and this is just a good bit easier. So that's nice. Another thing that we love about our new system is being able to filter within list views. So in Classic, you have the list view, and you can select a little button that says Edit to change whatever you're looking for. But in Lightning, you can select the filters from your same screen, and it will update directly. So you just press Apply, and it refilters your list. It's really nice for finding data. And then finally, the last thing that we super love about our new system with Lightning is creating new records within within the fields. So Kim, can you share a little bit about this?
Absolutely. This is one of my favorites as well. So when you, in Classic, if those of you are using Salesforce today, and let's say in this example here, you're creating a new opportunity and you need to assign it to the account that it's coming from or the campaign source that you're applying this to. And you get your opening, you do new opportunity, you start filling it out, and you search for the account, and you forgot to create the account. The account does not exist in your system. In Classic, you kind of have to stop what you're doing, go create that account, come back, you know, et cetera. Or maybe you forgot to create the campaign, something like that. In Lightning, you do your search, you realize, whoa, I don't have that account in my system. Instead of having to kind of leave what you're doing, right from that screen, that search screen, you'll see where she's got her red arrow there, it says new account. You just click new account. It opens up a little pop-up that allows you to create an account on the fly. You create it, you click save, and when you're done, it lands right back to where you were, and it's populated that account name field or that lookup field with the record you just created. So it's really, I think, a huge time saver.
That's great. Thanks, Kim.
Yeah.
Okay, great. So although all of these favorites are super fun, I wanted to tell you some of the biggest wins that we have seen from our system, some things that are more helpful when talking to management. One of the biggest wins for us has been that the interface is just more intuitive. Our users have really enjoyed it, which we were kind of surprised by. But I get comments like, It's just a whole lot easier to read, or in Lightning, it's faster to find what I'm looking for, which is a really big win for us. We were concerned about adding Lightning to the list of things that we were implementing, and we didn't want to overwhelm our users. So we're just really glad that they are finding that Lightning is easier. We've also had a couple new individuals start within our development and fundraising department, and it's been easier to train them, which is great, you know. It's just a lot more intuitive. Secondly, one of our other big wins has been that we can reduce our time spent on uploading data. So with the Nonprofit Success Pack, we've found a lot of reduction in how much time our users are spending uploading different Excel reports. Before, it used to take us probably in a moderately busy time, about a week, to upload our data because we had limits on how many records we could upload at one time. But now we're able to upload in just a few hours with the Nonprofit Success Pack upload. So that's great. That's a huge difference. And we're now able to allocate those users' time, that user's time, to other activities, which is really reducing our cost and making our process just a lot more efficient. Another big win for us has been being able to get rid of tasks through automation. So before, we created tasks, and then we accomplished them, and then we manually went in and closed those tasks. But now, an email that would have been sent through a task creation and then closing a task, that email is now sent through some automation that Cloud for Good has helped us set up within our system. So our fundraising individuals are also really excited about all this time that's being saved. And then our last biggest win, and one of our very biggest wins, has been the fact that we're able to integrate. This has literally changed our lives. We had been waiting on this for such a long time, and there have really been a lot of vendors that we hadn't gone with because we knew that they wouldn't actually be able to integrate with our Salesforce system, even though they touted some Salesforce integration. So before, in October, which is our busy season, we would have at least a solid 2 weeks of uploading data, and sometimes even more. And that's just from our Classy data. So when we were able to integrate Classy, we now have data automatically flowing through, and as a bonus, it's real time rather than delayed by a month. So these four items have really been the biggest wins for us internally. There's been a lot of time reduction in moving to our new system and also switching over to Lightning. But it's really changed almost all of how we work within our Salesforce system in a very good way. So we'd like to see what we can help you all with today, and we'd love to help you get started using Lightning on your own org. So Kim, do you mind telling us what the best next steps are to move to turn on Lightning in our org?
Sure, absolutely. So first of all, if you're using Salesforce today, if you're not in Lightning, you're in Classic, in the setup, you could have an admin run this for you if you're not the admin for your org. There is a Lightning Experience Migration Assistant, but basically what it does is the report that you ask to Salesforce to run for you just through your system. You click on it and say, analyze my system. It runs through your system. It produces a PDF document that it sends to you that says, hey, we've noticed in your org you are using all of this stuff, and that's all Lightning ready, and that's good. And you're using these other things that are Lightning ready, but you might need to do some work. Maybe you have a custom button that needs to be changed to something else so that it's more Lightning ready. Things of that nature. And then the third part, it tells you, these are some things that we noticed it looks like you're using. They're not ready for Lightning yet. So I really encourage you to analyze that report, look at it, and then you'll be ready to make a decision. It looks like our org is pretty ready to go. That's great. If there's things that are really important to your org that are not quite released on Lightning yet, then maybe you decide to wait a little bit. But that's a really good first step. After that, I would encourage you to turn over to Trailhead. If you haven't heard about Trailhead yet, Trailhead is offered by Salesforce. It's a free online training tool. It's very fun, gamified, it's very modular, and they have a number of Lightning-specific trails and modules. I would encourage you to go out there and log into those. They're bite-sized pieces of learning, and they're really good at explaining what Lightning is, how it works, what you need to do, what you need to understand, how do your users use it, how does the admin do it, things like that. So go out to Trailhead and take a look at the Lightning-related trails and modules. And then finally, the admin.salesforce.com website, they have a huge section on learning Lightning. So go out there. There's a lot of stuff for admins out on that site, but specifically there's a Lightning series. Go ahead and look at that. And see if you can understand more about what Lightning is, how it's different from Classic, what features it might provide that Classic is not going to provide for you, and things like that. So I would encourage you to do those three things and take it from there.
Perfect. Thank you so much, Kim. And thank you all so much for your time. We'd love to answer any questions that you have if you have them. So thank you.
Thank you, Jenna. Thank you, Kim. We do have a few questions that have come in. The first one is, do you use Chatter to help with Lightning?
Our development department has started testing out the use of Chatter. So they've used it just a little bit. It hasn't been something that we have fully implemented in our system yet, but they are currently like going back and forth on it, seeing what it can do and what emails it might be able to replace.
Okay, awesome. How long before you made the switch to Lightning did you start training your users?
Yeah, that's a good question. So we started our implementation last year in about January is when we kicked off the project, and that was when we were doing some of the analyze stage that Kim was mentioning. And then in June, we went live with our project. We probably started, we really started mentioning some things about Lightning and showing people views of what the Lightning system looked like all along the way, so from kind of January, February on. But then we did a large training session in June for our users just a couple weeks before we were officially in our new system. We had gone back and forth on whether to turn it on and then train our users, or whether to train our users while we were still in Classic and then turn it on afterwards. And we decided to train our users ahead of time, which we're really glad that we did. I think it gave our users a good level of comfort within the system before they had to find things in Lightning for their day-to-day use. And just so that you know, there's also the ability to switch back and forth between Classic and Lightning. So we don't really switch back very much, but at the beginning, users would switch back to find some, you know, real day-to-day things so that it didn't slow them down too much at first. So, yeah.
And I guess this is a good, you know, wrap-up question. Is there anything that was in Classic that you don't have in Lightning that you miss? Or are you finding everything to be there and pretty much just overall better experience?
Yeah, well, most things, so there were quite a few things that weren't in Lightning when we first switched over, but just about like every month something will be rolled out in NPSP Lightning. So most things are currently available in our Lightning system, but like one thing that I was using yesterday is sorting within the list view. I was talking about how you can filter while you're looking at the list view, but in order to create a new list view, you actually have to switch back to Classic to create like the name of a new one, and then save it, go into Lightning, and then you can use it. So if you're filtering based off of an existing list view, you can do that in Lightning currently. But if you are wanting to create a new list view, you would have to create it in Classic and then switch back. So that's the only thing that I can think of that really affects my day-to-day. Like I said, there are some admin functions, like I think merging accounts. I think you can't do that in Lightning right now. Kim, you might know. Everything I do day-to-day except for that list view thing is currently in Lightning.
Okay, great. Thank you, Jenna. That is all the questions for today. So I want to say a huge thank you to you and to Kim for participating in our webinar, and a big thank you to everyone who attended today. This webinar was recorded, and it will be posted on our website probably later today or tomorrow. And I also encourage you to go out if you haven't seen it. You could download a copy of our Salesforce fundraising trends report and catch some of those results that I was speaking of at the beginning by downloading the State of Salesforce and Nonprofit Sector report. Thank you all, and have a great afternoon.